Simon & Schuster Audio presents The 2084 Report, An Oral History of the Great Warming, by James Lawrence Powell. Read by Fajer Al-Kaisi, Danny Campbell, Feodor Chin, Cynthia Farrell, Katherine Littrell, Timothy Andrés Pabon, and Fred Sanders.
Preface to the second edition. They say that most writers write for themselves and hope that their book will turn into a bestseller. Nowadays, there is no way for any book, no matter how important and well-written, to sell enough copies to qualify as a bestseller. The big online booksellers depended entirely on the internet, which, like the rest of our infrastructure, has grown steadily less reliable and less secure, and will surely not survive to the end of the century. Almost all the physical bookstores that once could have maintained sales have long been put out of business by the online sellers. Why then did I write this book, knowing that it will be read mostly by friends and family? Because I am an oral historian. My job is to record significant events in human history using the words of those who experienced them. Thus, we provide the raw material from which other historians can synthesize and generalize. Of course, I also write because I like to, and writing is one pleasure that is still possible. You don't really need a working computer, the internet, and the so-called cloud. All you need is pencil and paper. The master of this approach and my model is the great 20th century oral historian Studs Terkel. Two of his books, The Good War, An Oral History of World War II, and Hard Times, An Oral History of the Great Depression, captured the effects of those calamities on Americans of all stripes as no other books ever did. All through my career, I have gone back to reread him, and he has never failed to inspire me. Studs traveled to interview people from all walks of life, from the farm to the factory, from city to town, from retirees to youngsters, from the lofty to the man and woman on the street. Like him, most of my subjects are average folks, though I include a few experts and leaders. I wound up interviewing nearly 100 people, too many for one book, and so I have chosen the interviews that best illustrate what flooding, drought, war, famine, disease, and mass migration of climate refugees have done to humankind. I feel a special affinity for Studs Terkel because I was born in 2012, exactly 100 years after his birth. In 1912, global warming was only a theoretical concept. A few scientists thought it might turn out to be real, but they had too little information to regard it as dangerous. Indeed, those scientists understandably thought that a warmer world might be better for humanity. By the year of my birth, a century later, it was beyond dispute that global warming was real, caused by humans, and a danger to humanity. Yet thanks to a campaign funded mainly by the giant oil companies of those days, half the public and many politicians chose denial, putting ideology and lies above their grandchildren's future. I have kept my role to a minimum, showing in italics where I asked a question, and otherwise letting my subjects speak for themselves, just as Studs did. For ease of reading, I have grouped chapters by topic, but this is somewhat arbitrary, as most regions suffer from more than one effect of global warming. Unless otherwise noted, I used a satellite telephone. Lexington, Kentucky, December 31st, 2084. The Climate Scientist. Today I talk with Robert Madsen III, who, like his father and grandfather before him, is a climate scientist. Dr. Madsen, I have come to you with a question that people in the second half of this century are compelled to ask. Those of us alive today are haunted by the question of why, Back in the first few decades of this century, before time had run out, people did not act to at least slow global warming. Was it because there was not enough evidence? Because scientists could not agree? Because there was some better theory to explain the warming that was obviously going on, or something else? Surely our grandparents' generation had a good reason for letting this happen to us. What was it?
Well, I can tell you that this will not be the longest chapter in your book, because the answer is short and simple. They did not have a good reason. Even at the turn of the century, the evidence for man-made global warming was overwhelming, and it only grew stronger until it became undeniable to any rational person. That is, anyone who used reason as their guide. A friend who had trained as a lawyer once asked me whether global warming had been supported by a preponderance of evidence, or beyond reasonable doubt, the higher standard in a criminal case. I answered that global warming had been beyond reasonable doubt, as certain as any scientific theory can be. If you were to go back to the 2010s and judge the collective opinion of scientists on the basis of what they published in peer-reviewed journals, you would find that by 2020, they were in 100% agreement that humans were the cause of global warming. That's not just a round number I plucked out of the air, but the result of a review of nearly 20,000 peer-reviewed articles from that period. Hard as it is to conceive, the global warming deniers had no scientific theory of their own to explain the evidence. It would be one thing if people in the 10s and 20s had allowed our world to be destroyed because they bet on the wrong theory. But there was no alternative theory. Temperatures rose. Wildfires grew worse every year on every continent. Sea level went higher and higher. Storms got worse, and on and on. Those who denied that humans were responsible had no curiosity about what was causing this extreme weather. But they had decided what was not. Fossil fuels.
All right, that is short and simple. But even deniers without a theory had to have some alternative way to explain the data that convinced scientists. How did they attempt that?
For a while, they said that global warming was a hoax, that conspiring scientists had faked the data. Those who deny science always get to the point of claiming conspiracy eventually, for the only other choice is to admit that scientists are right.
If you had been around in those days, how would you have responded to those who claimed that man-made global warming was a conspiracy?
Well, I would have urged people to ask themselves a few simple questions. How was the conspiracy organized? Those 20,000 articles would have had roughly 60,000 authors from countries all over the world. How could the hoaxers have kept everything straight? They would have had to use email. But back in the first decade, someone stole and published a trove of emails from prominent climate scientists. Almost 1 million words, as I recall. Not one word in those emails ever gave any hint of a conspiracy. Why then did no conspirator ever get caught, write a tell-all memoir, or make a deathbed confession? And why would they have conspired in the first place? In America, the denier's answer was, because they were liberals. But more than half the scientific papers were coming from other countries, where that label did not apply. But, of course, by the 2010s, the deniers did not ask themselves these sort of questions. To them, that global warming was false was so obvious that the reason scientists would have mounted a hoax no longer mattered. By the 2020s, lies had come to replace truth, not just in regard to science, but in many areas. People preferred to accept a lie that supported their prior belief rather than a truth that undercut that belief. This allowed countries such as Australia, Brazil, Russia, and the United States to elect science deniers to lead them. Even as late as the early 20s, warming could have been limited to 5.4 degrees Fahrenheit, 3 degrees Celsius. But the nations of the world could not bring themselves to even try. By the time they did, even 7.2 degrees Fahrenheit, 4 degrees Celsius, was no longer an option. We don't know how high the temperature may go. It's a strange thing. We humans pride ourselves on being ruled by reason, yet with human civilization at stake, we chose ideology and ignorance.
If people thought scientists were so crooked as to fake global warming, it must have been hard to trust scientists on anything else. Did that attitude have an effect on the status of science itself?
My grandfather was a scientist, and inspired me to become one too. He told me how, by the late 1910s, science deniers occupied the White House and the top tiers of nearly every government agency. They cut research funding not only for climate science, but for anything having to do with the environment, endangered species, industrial pollution, and so on. The Environmental Protection Agency and the National Science Foundation did not survive the 2020s, and overall federal funding for science fell to the level of the 1950s. Granddad said that to him and his colleagues, it almost seemed like science had become a dirty word. Most university scientists back then depended on government grants and had to give up their research programs. Large universities had gotten 25% to 30% of their overall funding as overhead on research grants. One of the first things they did was reduce funding for science departments and lay off faculty. Students, seeing no future in studying science, voted with their feet to take classes in other subjects. Science enrollment dwindled, justifying the elimination of more science departments and faculty. Science journals, whose main customers were universities, also fell victim, as the volume of research plummeted and as funding for university libraries dropped and then disappeared. Of course, without research funding and journals, the many science societies also had to close their doors. In my granddad's book collection, I found a well-thumbed volume titled The End of History and the Last Man. We may not be at the end of science, but you can see it coming.
Part 1. Drought and Fire. Morocco in Switzerland. Christian Mercier is the longtime global warming correspondent for the French newspaper Le Monde. In this interview, she speaks to me from several different locations in Europe. Our first conversation in the series took place at the former Swiss ski resort of Zermatt.
I am making this tour to take stock of what global warming has done to different locations in Europe. I'm standing at the heart of the former Swiss tourism industry, where skiing is no longer possible. Zermatt once had world-class ski slopes and a fabulous view of the Matterhorn. As I look around now, there is no snow to be seen anywhere, not even on the summit of the Matterhorn itself. To prepare for this interview, I did some research on the history of global warming in the Alps. Even fin du siècle, there were ominous signs. In those days, the snow line extended down 9,940 feet, 330 meters. But in the deadly hot summer of 2003, for example, it rose to 15,100 feet, 4,600 meters, higher than the summit of the Matterhorn, and almost as high as the summit of Mont Blanc, the highest peak west of the Caucasus. The permafrost that held the rock and soil on the Matterhorn melted, sending debris tumbling downhill. You can still see the debris piles resting against, and even inside, the shuttered ski lodges and restaurants. I could give the same report from Davos, Gstaade, St. Moritz, or any of the once famous ski resorts in Switzerland, France, and Italy. The Alps have not had permanent snow and ice since the 2040s. I understand that the Rocky Mountain ski slopes have met the same fate. Meteorologists tell us that the climate of southern Europe today is the same as it was in Algeria and Morocco when the century began. As measured by temperature and precipitation, southern Europe is now a desert, and the Alps are well on their way to resembling the Atlas Mountains of those days.
Several weeks later, Ms. Mercier was in Nerja on Spain's sun coast, once host to expatriates and seasonal visitors escaping the cold winters of Germany and the United Kingdom.
Looking south from the waterfront at Nerja, spread before me is the vast blue Mediterranean. Looking north, stretching seemingly forever, is a sea of abandoned buff and ochre condominiums, thousands, tens of thousands, an incomprehensible number, most of them decayed and crumbling. It is not hard to understand why. The countryside is parched and dead. At 2 p.m. in the afternoon in front of the ruins of the Hotel Balcon on the Nerja waterfront, the temperature in the shade is 124 degrees Fahrenheit, 51 degrees Celsius, and there is no sea breeze to be felt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.